on Unsolved Mysteries. A professional motorcycle racer falls over dead in a gas station. What happened? A new church member gains the trust of the congregation and then scams more than $1 million. He steals much of it using ATMs. A popular cheerleader is found dead in the woods. Who killed her? And a rash of child kidnappings in California leads one mother to take action. These are stories with intriguing secrets and surprising revelations. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Emeryville, California, just across the bay from San Francisco. On a warm February evening, a motorcycle rider weaves erratically down the road and into a gas station. Police and paramedics arrive quickly. They try to revive the unconscious rider.
Okay, continue compression. Let's get that back over here. Let's get him out of here.
His pulse is very weak, but he doesn't seem injured. Medics cannot find any external wounds.
Two, three.
There was no bleeding at all at the site. If it had been some kind of an accident, you would expect to see some kind of blood. But there was absolutely none.
The motorcyclist was rushed to a nearby hospital, where they discovered that he had been shot 3 times by a small caliber weapon.
One, two, three.
One of the bullets shattered his knee. A second lodged in his stomach. The third and fatal bullet punctured his aorta. The wounds were nearly invisible, but had caused massive internal bleeding. The rider never regained consciousness and was pronounced dead shortly after 9 p.m. His name was Michael Hunter. At 30 years old, he was a dedicated motorcycle racer who had survived hundreds of dangerous competitions only to be gunned down. But why?
What happened to Michael Hunter is all too common. An innocent person is murdered, the killer walks away, and the police are left without a suspect or a motive. As investigators examined Michael's life, they looked for anything that might have set the stage for his murder.
Michael Hunter competed in races throughout California. He earned a reputation as one of the state's most skilled bikers.
He said that racing gave him probably the highest high that he'd ever had in his whole life. He said there was nothing that beat this excitement and the thrill of the racing. And I think the competition was maybe almost incidental to the thrill of the racing.
He was always sharing, always teaching. Mike took me in hand from the beginning and taught me how to ride, taught me how to ride safely. He taught me how to ride clean.
On the night that he was killed, Michael fired up his customized red, white, and blue Honda Interceptor and took off from home. A few minutes later, he stopped at an ATM a half a mile away. As he withdrew $20 from his checking account, a security camera recorded the transaction.
From the photographs that we have, it would appear to be an uneventful withdrawal. So we don't have any reason to think that he was robbed or shot at the ATM machine.
Michael next showed up at a liquor store a half a block from the ATM. There, he bought a pint of whiskey that was later found in his jacket. What happened next is pure speculation. The police believe that Michael headed to a frontage road 3 miles from the gas station. This area was known for its breathtaking view of the Bay Bridge. It was here, while enjoying the fresh winter breeze, that Michael Hunter may have encountered his killer or killers. Police theorize that someone robbed Michael at gunpoint and then demanded his motorcycle.
Probably Mike's love of his motorcycle would cause him to be reluctant to turn it over.
I think that he was probably pretty scared, and I really like to believe that he didn't know what was going on. It would have taken him a long time to get to that station. That's not a short stint to ride when you're hurt.
An hour later, Michael Hunter was dead, leaving his family to wonder who killed him and why.
I think all the time he raced, I knew that something could happen to him because he was living beyond what most people do as far as is what he chose to do for his recreation. Had he died that way, it was a choice he would made and a conscious choice he'd made. And I think that it would have been a lot easier to accept.
Michael's friends and family have raised a $10,000 reward for information which may help solve this case. If you know anything about the murder of Michael Hunter, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Coming up, 5 children are abducted in Northern California. Can a mysterious stranger help solve these puzzling cases? Pinole, California. On a Friday afternoon, Kim Swartz was preparing dinner when her 7-year-old daughter, Amber, asked if she could play outside.
Oh, but our friends are gonna be here in 5 minutes.
Please.
Amber asked if she could use the jump rope in the hall closet and jump rope outside. So I walked with her over to the closet and opened up the door, and she grabbed the jump rope.
Thank you, Mommy. I love you.
On her way out the door, she just stopped and turned and said, I love you, Mommy, and out the door she went.
Amber planted jump rope until the guests arrived.
Hello,
hi. How are you two? Come in.
They walked in the door, and, you know, Marisa instantly asks where Amber was. I said she was outside jumping rope, and so both of them at that point said, we didn't see her out there. So I said, well, maybe she was over in the vacant lot.
No, she's out there. Go get her.
So Marisa quickly ran back outside looking for Amber. And
glad it's Friday.
Oh, me too.
Yeah.
She came running back inside saying she didn't see her. And so at that point, I went outside. Couldn't find Amber. I was afraid. And I didn't want anything to be wrong. I wanted her to be home.
Kim Swartz would never see Amber again. Following hours of searching, investigators concluded that Amber had been abducted. The morning after she disappeared, a pair of pink socks was discovered in a park near Amber's home. The socks had not been there when the park was searched the night before.
To come back the next morning and find these socks in a place that had already been searched certainly sent up a lot of red flags. They were just like the socks that Amber had on her feet, I could say that. That's because I had helped Amber put her new shoes on that we had just bought.
In the days following Amber's disappearance, many strangers offered to help. But one of them, Kim will never forget. His name was Tim Binder.
Hello, Kim. My name's Timothy. I'm with the search for Amber, for your dear Amber.
She's such a lovely girl. It looked like he'd been up all night. basically was saying how he wanted to be the one to save her. He wanted to be the one to bring her home to me.
I've been searching in a lot of places that...
Binder's van also caught Kim's attention.
Because I know him.
It almost looked like a van that he painted himself. He's got these plates that say, love you. He's got posters on the outside of the van.
So I want you to know, I want to be the one to find her.
Kim says Binder became extremely emotional as he talked about Amber.
I want to be the one to save her and bring her back to you.
Did you see Amber Swartz on June 3rd?
No.
Binder was questioned extensively by the FBI following Amber's disappearance. The results of his polygraph were inconclusive.
Tim Binder is a very bright man. He's a very intelligent man. He's a Berkeley grad.
John Philpin is a trained forensic psychologist. He spent more than 1,000 hours interviewing Tim Binder for his book, Stalemate, which was about Amber's disappearance.
There are law enforcement agencies which consider him a suspect. There's also the perception shared by a number of people that Tim has done absolutely nothing wrong and that he is a misunderstood Good Samaritan.
Point of fact is he is trying to be helpful. He does that voluntarily. It is a sense that he has, an obligation and a duty to go out and try to find missing children.
But what has authorities curious about Binder is his apparent fascination with the grave of another murdered girl, Angela Bouguet. 5-year-old Angela disappeared 4.5 years before Amber. She was later found sexually assaulted and strangled. The FBI placed Tim Binder under surveillance. His alleged habit of visiting Angela Bouguet's gravesite up to 90 times a year had caught their attention.
To have been to this little girl's grave, this little girl that he never knew, I just can't imagine anybody going to somebody's grave that many times in that period of time, unless there's something else going on in that person's mind.
According to John Burris, the fact that Binder visits grave sites should not cast suspicion on his client.
For him, it has a special kind of significance that is personal to him, but certainly not an indication that he's put anybody in that graveyard.
11 days after Amber vanished, a bloodhound from the Contra Costa County Sheriff's Department allegedly tracked her scent to Angela's gravesite. Police say the dog also picked up Amber's scent in Binder's van. However, California courts are often leery about the reliability of bloodhound evidence. 5 months after Amber's disappearance, another young girl in the area was abducted. 9-year-old Michaela Garrett. But she wasn't the last. 2 months later, in nearby Dublin, 13-year-old Eileen Misselhoff disappeared. Despite the fact that some suspicion had been directed at him, Tim Binder helped search for Eileen. Several years passed and little progress was made. And then a woman in the town of Fairfield informed police that her daughter had begun receiving mail from a man she didn't know. His name, Tim Binder.
One young girl was getting letters from Tim. Oddly enough, these letters were written backwards and they had to be held up to a mirror to read, which I'm sure would set any parent on edge, you know, to have your kid all of a sudden get this really weird letter.
I'm gonna play with my friends.
Just a few blocks from where the letter was received, another young girl disappeared. 4-year-old Nikki Campbell was playing in her driveway.
Nikki lived on Salisbury Drive in Fairfield, and she had been out playing with her brother in the afternoon. Mom came home from work, asked where's Nikki while she's out playing. They couldn't find her.
4 days after Nikki's disappearance, her scent, like Amber's before her, was allegedly tracked by bloodhounds to Angela Bouguet's grave, the same grave that Tim Binder reportedly visited.
you put all of these coincidences together, you see them pile up, the dogs, the cemetery, the various scents in the various places, and you really have to question, which is what I believe law enforcement was doing, and I think it's their role to do it. Is this a coincidence or is there something to it?
If there was something more to it, then you would think after all this time there had been some more evidence that was more definitive, and there hasn't been any.
Following Nikki Campbell's disappearance, the Fairfield Police Department searched Tim Binder's home. They found nothing suspicious. Believing that his reputation had been unfairly tarnished by the Fairfield Police Department, Binder brought a defamation lawsuit against the city. Fairfield settled out of court for $90,000.
Citing the advice of his attorney, Binder turned down our request for an interview. And it's important to note that Tim Binder has never been charged with any crime relating to the disappearance of these girls. He has consistently claimed that he is innocent.
Kim Swartz has not given up her search for the person who kidnapped Amber. This effort led her to create the Amber Foundation for Missing Children. Kim hopes to prevent child abductions so that what happened to her never happens to anyone else. Update. The body of Angela Bouguet, the first of the five girls to disappear, was exhumed and tested for the DNA of her killer. The results led to the arrest of a man named Larry Christopher Graham, who had once dated Angela's mother. Graham was convicted of raping and killing the five-year-old and sentenced to death. Tim Binder was not involved in any way. There are new developments in this case. Here's one of our staff with details.
21 years after she disappeared from her front yard, police and the FBI now believe they know who kidnapped and killed Amber Swartz. During a prison interview with the FBI, convicted child killer Curtis Dean Anderson confessed to abducting Amber from her front yard, murdering her in a Tucson, Arizona motel room, and disposing of her body in the Arizona desert. Anderson was serving a 300-year sentence in connection with the killing and sexual molestation of other children. Just 30 days after confessing to Amber's murder, Anderson died in prison. While they were never able to conduct a polygraph, FBI profilers who interviewed Anderson are convinced he was telling the truth, and the case has been closed.
Up next, a friendly con man dips into the church offering basket and makes off with more than $1 million. In Virginia Beach, Virginia, the Holy Family Church serves a small, tight-knit Hispanic community. The parishioners are honest and hardworking, but by no means wealthy. When Carlos Garcia arrived, he was warmly welcomed into the congregation. He was a gregarious businessman who quickly made friends with everyone.
What really struck me about him when he first came to us was how honest he seemed to be and how concerned he seemed to be for the people of our community, for the Hispanic people, especially with the Mexicans. He was extremely close to the Mexican community, and he earned their trust immediately, just like he earned mine.
Let me just say how excited I am. We've had a great year.
Within 3 years, Garcia had been elected president and treasurer of the local pastoral council, which oversaw the church budget and expenditures. It was a powerful position, and slowly Garcia began to use it to his own advantage.
On page one, all the items that have an asterisk, you'll find the explanation on page two.
There was, for many people, almost an immediate trust that this is somebody who has come to this country, who has become successful, and now is helping other people.
Okay, can we approve the minutes?
Unfortunately, we found out that the trust that had been put in Carlos had been betrayed in just in many ways.
What
Garcia used his position in the church to attract clients to his tax business. One couple gave him more than $13,000 to turn over to the IRS, but Carlos kept every penny.
We didn't know how the system worked here for paying taxes and all that. He helped us arrange our citizenship, our immigration cards, and he always helped us with everything. So that's why we trusted him so much. And that's why we trusted him with our taxes.
He takes advantage of the fact that a great many of the individuals he comes in contact with are unfamiliar with federal income tax laws. They trust him to guide them through what really must appear a maze. Unfortunately, they don't realize that he has no intention of taking them anywhere but to the cleaners, so to speak.
Garcia's tax scam was just the beginning. Using church records, he got confidential information about hundreds of community members. He used it to order credit cards in the names of fellow churchgoers and their dead relatives.
He would use the information that he obtained about other people to build resumes, obtain credit cards, establish bank accounts. And with his credit cards, he even assumed the identities of females. And he would charge things on these credit cards. And he would explain to them that sometimes a name that you would assume would be female was not, because it was a Hispanic name. And he got away with it.
Carlos was also something of a ladies' man. One woman, who we'll call Anna, dated him for 6 years and never realized what he was up to. When Carlos learned that Anna's mother inherited a lot of money, he encouraged her to put it in a CD.
He told her that the interest rate would be better at his credit union, and he had already picked up the signature cards and everything and brought those with him. So she filled out the application and the signature card, and he took the money and he put it in the credit union.
I think it's an excellent investment.
Well, thank you, Carlos.
What Anna and her mother didn't realize was that Garcia had co-signed the signature card. Before long, he emptied the account of $25,000. Finally, after 8 years, one of Garcia's clients became suspicious and contacted the IRS.
The taxpayer alleged that she had given Carlos cash monies for three consecutive years for Carlos to send to the Internal Revenue Service. She subsequently learned that IRS did not have any record of her filing or any payments made to the Internal Revenue Service.
She made a phone call to Carlos to discuss her situation.
Hello?
He had no idea that the IRS inspectors were listening in.
Carlos, I'm calling because I've received some letters from the IRS, and they say that they haven't received payments from me. And, you know, I paid you in cash, and I don't have any record of it.
Obviously, there's been a terrible mistake. I will call them on Monday morning and straighten this whole situation out.
Well, so you do have the record, then. You can prove to them that I gave you the payment in cash.
Yes, I've got those records. I know you paid me. I've got everything right here.
I will take care of it. You understand?
Okay, then I'll wait to hear from you. Thank you, Carlos.
Bye-bye.
Garcia was arrested a few days later. He soon posted bail, and within a week, he had slipped out of Virginia Beach and vanished. When the IRS searched through Garcia's records, they discovered his true identity, Fernando Zapico. Zapico is a native of Argentina. He's a career con man whose life of crime spans more than four decades. He has used at least 17 aliases to defraud victims of nearly $2 million.
Probably even greater than the loss of funds from our Hispanic community has been the loss of trust. And the real betrayal that people have felt of someone whom they loved and respected and truly looked up to as a leader of our community. And now they find that they've been betrayed by him.
I still have time when it's hard for me to accept this. I still have times when I feel like cry, when I feel depressed, because I trusted him. I believed in him. He took money from people that were simple people. Again, people that trusted him. And these people will never be the same again. The whole community will never be the same again.
Update.
After decades of bilking innocent victims, Fernando Zapico has been captured. He was working at a convenience store in Miami, Florida, when one of our viewers recognized him and notified authorities, who moved in quickly to make the arrest.
Fernando Zapico pleaded guilty to bank fraud, credit fraud, and other felonies, and was sentenced to 2 years in federal prison. He has since been released. Next, a high school cheerleader is murdered near campus. We need your help to catch the killer. East Millinocket, Maine. A peaceful mill town where kids play in the parks unsupervised and most people don't even lock their doors. But that sense of safety ended when 16-year-old Joyce McLean was murdered. Her body was found in the woods behind the high school's soccer field.
I saw Joyce and she wasn't moving. Her body looked like it had been beaten.
Joyce!
I knew that she wasn't alive. Joyce! And after that, I turned and ran home and called the police. Turned out to be a big part in my life that's really hurt me. I never expected what happened at all.
It's just something in a little town like this that you don't forget. It's there all the time. There's not a day that goes by that her name isn't mentioned, mainly because she was such a bright, beautiful young girl, so talented, she made such a mark on this town that people just didn't forget.
Over 6,000 signatures were collected petitioning Unsolved Mysteries to tell Joyce's story. The people of her hometown feel that it may be the last chance to find the person who killed their friend and their neighbor, Joyce McLean.
She was the kind of teenager that would make any hometown proud. Joyce was a gifted musician who played in the school orchestra and composed her own music. She was an honor student, cheerleader, and student body officer.
Joyce's mind was filled with thoughts of what kind of a future she was going to have. She was heading into a new step in life. She was getting her driver's license. She was going to turn 17 years old. She had a big party planned at the beach with a big band and lots of friends and family was going to be there. I believe that it was a growing up time.
On a Friday evening, Joyce went for her usual jog around the school. It was the last time that she was seen alive.
Joyce had a route that took her out around the town and behind Skank High School. And the last time she was seen is turning the corner, going down to the softball field and the soccer field, where she usually did a number of laps. We have witnesses that say this happened roughly between 7:45 and 8:00 in the evening.
The field was a popular hangout. One theory is that some locals were drinking there and began harassing Joyce. They may have forced her into the woods intending to rape her. Instead, it ended in murder. A second theory is that Joyce was attacked by one or more workers from the local paper mill. 300 laborers who were not local residents had just been hired. But after intense investigation, the case remains unsolved.
Before she was murdered, all of us kids would all go out walking around like 6:00. We were all out on the street. And after she was murdered, it all changed. the parents were real, you know, where are you going, what time are you going to be home, and people never even locked their doors around here. People started locking up their houses, and I mean, everybody was just in a panic. It was like, it's something you least expect around here.
Can you imagine living in a town where people are aware that these killers have never been found? They may very well be still walking our streets. The town is, it's been like a pressure cooker, just ready to explode.
I believe that Joyce's murder is solvable. And I believe out there someone has just the tiniest bit of information. They may not even know it. They could come forward and it could be solved.
Update. An arrest has been made in this case. Here's one of our staff with details.
After a 35-year investigation, Philip Scott Fournier, 55, was arrested and charged with the murder of Joyce McLean. Fournier was 19 at the time of Joyce's death, and he had been interviewed nearly two dozen times since her murder. He allegedly told his mother and several other witnesses that he had killed McLean. He is pleading not guilty to the crime.
Next, the amazing journey of a note in a bottle and its 18-year odyssey around the world. Ovid, New York, near Lake Cayuga. One summer day, 9-year-old Kevin Reeder and his mother Merle were at the lake. They tried a little experiment.
Find this bottle?
I know. Please drop me a line.
Perfect.
They signed a note with Kevin's name and address and then tucked it inside an old bottle.
Good? Yeah.
Okay. All right, you go ahead. Give it a good throw. Go ahead. Good arm.
Mom?
What's weird?
How far do you think it could go?
I don't know.
We thought somebody around Aurora might find it, or it would go to the south end of the lake, to Ithaca, where there's college kids, and they might be interested and see where it went and write to Kevin and give him a new pen pal.
After we tossed the bottle into the lake, it was part of a daily thought process, waiting for the mail, checking the mail, the anticipation, until it progressively faded away, until you forgot entirely about it.
Years passed. Kevin Reeder grew up and moved away from New York, first to Florida, then to Texas. Kevin had no idea that he had launched the bottle on its own epic journey. 18 years later, Kevin returned to Ovid to find a letter waiting for him. It had arrived only days before. Inside was the message that he had put in the bottle almost two decades earlier. It came with a short note from the people who found it.
When I called my mother, the first thing that came out of my mouth was, "You're never gonna believe this." It says, "Hello, Kevin. I found your message in a bottle, like that song, at the beach in San Diego, California. I thought it would be funny to write back, pretty cool." It was signed by Rosa and Bruce. And it has a P.S. Where the heck is Ovid? But there's no return address or phone number.
In 20 years, the bottle had apparently traveled more than 3,000 miles by land and some 25,000 miles by sea. So, how could a glass bottle get across the entire continent from a lake in New York to the Pacific coast?
That is really amazing. I think it's a bit unlikely because of all the difficulties to get there. But that is truly amazing, but not impossible.
Go ahead.
Dr. Richardson is one of the world's top experts on global water currents. Here's how Dr. Richardson says this well-traveled bottle might have maneuvered through the waterways of the world. First, the bottle would have floated out of the lake through the Erie Canal into the St. Lawrence Seaway and then out into the Atlantic Ocean near Nova Scotia.
Well, that's the hardest part because it's so easy for a bottle to go ashore and be found by someone. Once it gets into the Atlantic, it's easy for a bottle to stay adrift for many years.
Dr. Richardson speculates that a combination of tides, winds, and ocean currents could have taken the bottle around the world. From Nova Scotia, south down the eastern seaboard, and then east towards Europe, down the west coast of Africa, and then across to South America. The bottle was swept back across the Atlantic, past the Cape of Good Hope, and into the Indian Ocean, then east until it reached the South Pacific. Currents pushed it back across the Pacific, then north past the Philippine Islands and Japan. After that, the bottle would have had to cross the Pacific yet again, head down the west coast of North America, and reach its final destination, San Diego, California. It would have been a magnificent voyage, but Dr. Richardson himself has some doubts it really happened.
I'm a bit skeptical. I think it went to California in someone's pocket or someone's suitcase. Very difficult to get out through the canals and rivers without going aground or being found by someone.
Those someones were Bruce and Rosa. Although they did not give their last names or a return address, Kevin's mother feels that she knows at least a little something about them.
They had to have some kind of a sense of humor to be able to pick it up and open it, read it, and then, you know, send our note back, say, where the heck is Ovid?
I like to picture it as a couple strolling the beach and just coming upon it and taking the time and energy to allow somebody to revisit their childhood like they've allowed me to do, and also just to thank them for it.
The incredible journey of Kevin's message in a bottle may be one of our quirkier mysteries, but we're hoping that Bruce and Rosa can provide the final chapter in this intriguing story. If you know Bruce or Rosa, please contact us at unsolved.com. Queens, New York. Jean and Don Warren were the parents of three daughters and had always wanted a son. Their dream seemed to come true the day that a two-year-old foster child named Roger arrived at their home. For Jean, being a foster mother had special meaning.
I was a foster child, and because of this, I wanted a foster child to do what somebody did for me.
Hello, Roger. Welcome to our family.
It's the tender, loving care. To me, this is what's important, giving a child the love, the attention that he needed, and not just a bed to sleep in.
Roger, this is Carol
and Wendy
and Donna.
Donna, this is Roger.
Hi, do you want to come and play with my toys?
He was kind of shy, but Donna, she was a year older than Roger, and she took to him. Within a year's time, I have to say, Roger developed so wonderfully. He started smiling a lot, laughing a lot. You know, he was no longer that shy little boy that walked in that day.
You're doing real good, Roger. I'm proud of you.
I think adjusting in our family was the best thing for Roger. Whatever we did, he was there with us. And each day I was loving this child more and more and more.
But after 3 years, Don and Jean had to move from New York to Ohio. They were heartbroken to learn that they could not take Roger with them.
I questioned the agency because I wanted to adopt Roger. And they told me that was impossible because a foster child couldn't be taken out of state.
Come on, Roger. Time to go.
Jean will never forget the day that Roger was taken away.
When she took him to the car, he looked at us and looked at me, and I remember him putting out his hand and crying, "I don't want to go, I don't want to go." And
you'll be a good boy, Roger.
I could only say, "Roger, be good, take care of yourself, and I love you, and I'll always remember you."
Jean never forgot Roger and never stopped hoping to find him. Update. Jean Warren's 30-year search is finally over. Roger was watching Unsolved Mysteries the night this story aired and rushed to see the woman he still calls Mom.
Oh, you are handsome. How are you?
I was ecstatic.
So beautiful.
My heart started pounding. I would like him and his wife to be a part of our family. And it's so nice to hear him call me Mom. That makes it all worthwhile.
Hi, Wendy. I feel so much love for that woman.
Carol.
She has changed my life.
As the oldest girl.
I got a family overnight. Overnight, I got a family, and I'm a happy man.
Here. These are the pictures of your life of the 3 years that you spent with us.
Baby. The reunion with Jean was a huge success, but there was more to come. A viewer contacted our phone center saying he was Roger's brother. They'd been separated as toddlers and out of contact for nearly three decades.
Hey, Roger, how you
doing? What's happening?
It's unbelievable. There's no feeling in the world you could imagine is not to have a family, and then 30 years later in your life, you see somebody that's like you is indescribable.
I'm overwhelmed. I really am. I found my foster mother. I found my brother. I couldn't see leaving this world without knowing where I came from. Now I know.
But believe it or not, there was still more to come. In the weeks since their reunion, Roger and James found their father, Philip Sr., and met their brother, Philip Jr. This case has come to a successful conclusion, but several others we profiled still need your help. If you have any information, please log on to our website at unsolved.com.